We join in the stories of the prophets,
who challenge us to act in ways consistent with our hopes, desires, and dreams.
We join in the stories of Elizabeth and Zechariah, Mary and Joseph,
who dare to trust that the impossible is possible through God's love.
We join in the stories of all those who suffer in our world,
who call us to repentance and to walk in new ways of peace.
We join in the stories of those who live on the margins,
who we hold vigil with as we wait for good news of great joy for all people.
Let us enter again into the great story of Jesus coming into our world.
May these stories inspire us as we light a candle and proclaim together as one, O come, Emmanuel. This Advent, we know the pain of exile, unable to gather together in the spaces that bring us comfort and meaning. Yet in our dispersed form of worship, our rituals can still offer us hope, forming us for the unknown journey ahead, pointing us to the one who lights our way. Today, we invite you to light one candle on your Advent wreath at home. Notice the flame as it begins to grow. Imagine the one small tongue of fire holds God's desires, hopes, and dreams for you, your family, and our world. Allow it to kindle your hope. Please light one candle on your Advent wreath.
As we begin this Advent season, we light a candle for the prophets who proclaimed God's hopes, desires, and dreams. Let us keep their flame growing strong in our hearts, even now, no matter the disappointments, setbacks, or delays. May our hope for the future translate into action in the present as we come alive in the story of Jesus.
Set thy people free from
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of the prophets,
your vision of hope and purpose for all people has lived on through generations of the faithful. Though empires and tyrants have threatened to extinguish their flame, it lives on today in and through us, and all who continue to act with humility and love. Join us again with your prophets and guide our footsteps and the road we make by walking as we love, live, and give like Jesus. Amen.
Shines in the darkness,
and the darkness has not overcome it.
Today's reading comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 67 through 79. May we be equipped by these words to walk in love for God, ourselves, our neighbors, all people, and all God's creation. Then John's father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke this prophecy. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant. The oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in the darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ. We have many ways as human beings that we tell the passage of time. We think about this very much during this holiday season because holidays are often times where we measure the passage of time. Think about just the fall season. When we hit Labor Day at the beginning of September, that for us generally marks the end of summer, the beginning of a school year, and the beginning of the fall season, of which we know that there are many important passages that will come. We know that then soon after that, Halloween will happen. And for many of us, as we grew up, we knew that Halloween was the transition point between where we enjoyed the fall and to where soon it would be Thanksgiving and Christmas to follow. But we know how quickly that time period then continues to go from Halloween on into Thanksgiving, which we just celebrated this last week. And we then know how quickly these next 26 days go between Thanksgiving and Christmas. But yet then, right after Christmas, comes one last seasonal passage that we all tend to celebrate, and that is the celebration of New Year's. And for many of us, that is the transition point where we can put to rest everything that happened in the past year, the good and the bad, and we can move on and have a fresh start, a new beginning. Now, I'll tell you this, I don't know if it's true for you all, but I have had a lot of people talking about they just can't wait to get to New Year's this year. They can't wait to put 2020 behind them and say, let's just move on with the new, as if by changing a number in our year going to 2021, all of a sudden we're going to go from the difficulties of this year on in to a new year. Now, we know that that's not true, that simply going from 11:59 p.m. to midnight on the clock doesn't miraculously change the realities of our world, but it exemplifies hope. Hope that something new is possible. Hope that a new way is coming. Hope that there can be new life and new experiences that can give us a new hope to hold on to as we go into the days ahead. But for us as the church, our new year is a little bit different than the traditional new year, where we just wish that new things will happen. For us as the church, we celebrate the beginning of a new year today on this very first Sunday of Advent. And we begin our new year not with a recognition that today is a new start of what can come, but we begin today with the awareness that what is, the reality of now, is not so good. That right now we acknowledge that we are dwelling in darkness, and the days are continuing to get darker, and that we as people are struggling to make sense of how to continue to live. That's not just true in 2020 for us today, but that's been true for people throughout all time. I mean, I think about 2019, and there were plenty of people that at the end of 2019 that said this year was terrible as well, and they just wanted to move forward. For us as people, the beginning of a new church year, the beginning of Advent, helps us to recognize that the moment that we are living in is always, in some way, shape, or form, shrouded in darkness, in struggle, in a pathway that is unknown. And I think that that's a valuable place for us to start today, is the recognition, not that we are ready for a new start, but simply that we are in a place where we can cry out to God and say, God, we are in the midst of the darkness. We are lost in the unknown. We pray, we cry out for you to come and to give us light and to show us a new way forward. That's where we begin our new year. And it's at the beginning of the new year that we enter into these stories of the prophets. There have always been prophets throughout time that have given guidance to God's people, reminding them of their desires and their hopes and their dreams for the future that they hope to inhabit someday to come. And that those prophets then remind the people of the ways of life that they can live out to prepare them for that future and those desires, hopes, and dreams that they want to inhabit. I think about the prophet Isaiah and the writings that we have in the Old Testament. Now, for the people of Israel that lived in the time of the prophet Isaiah, the year 587 BC was probably just about as equivalent to the year 2020 for us. It was the year where everything fell apart, and it felt like nothing good was happening. In 587, the final tribes of Israel were conquered by the Babylonians as they destroyed the temple and took over Jerusalem and then exiled God's people from the land that they had been living in. It was a terrible year, a year that people, I'm sure, wanted to escape and move on from, just like we do this year in 2020. But as we look at the prophet Isaiah and the writings held in the book of Isaiah, we know that the first 39 chapters of that book actually were leading up to that moment in 587 with the prophet calling out to God's people to turn away from their corruption and their self-centeredness and to say, look out, your ways of life that you're inhabiting right now are going to have grave consequences for something that's going to happen in the future. And sure enough, that destruction of the people happened in 587. And then the remaining books in the book of Isaiah are meant to be words to inspire the people who are either exiled under the Babylonians or later on the Assyrians as they yearn to return to a time where they could worship, to see the temple rebuilt, and to live freely in relationship with their God and with one another, to be liberated and to be freed from the difficulties and struggles of life that they were living. And so in the book of Isaiah, we see an example of how the prophets operate. That yes, they call us to repentance and to new ways of life to avoid destruction and difficult ways of life that may come in the future. But the prophets also provide hope for God's people who are exiled and are living in the difficulties of the present moment, offering them hope and reminding them of what life will be like again in the future, reminding them that they have a hope to hold on to when they return to God, whose mercy and faithfulness will always be there to turn to again. It is the tradition of the book of Isaiah and the prophet Isaiah that the contemporaries of Jesus and the prophets of Jesus' time also looked to as models of how to draw God's people into relationship with God again. And as we heard those words from Luke's gospel today, the words offered from Zechariah, the son of John, speaking about his son, who was the one to come to prepare the way for Jesus, we recognize that John himself is living out that same framework of being a prophet like Isaiah. And that John was calling out to the people of Jesus' time to come to the Jordan River, to repent of those ways of life that were self-centered and that were causing problems for them, their families, and their communities, and to be baptized, to repent of that way of life, to turn around from how they had been living so that they can then live a new way, to prepare the way for the coming of Christ, God's presence in their midst. John reminded the people who were yearning for a new way that God was there with them, and then John called them to specific, tangible, faithful, and hopeful action in their time. The action was repentance, but the action was also a life of preparation, a life of prayer and a life of worship and service so that they could be prepared to live into this new way that Jesus was coming to show them, to have their hearts be opened up and ready for Jesus to teach them and show them the way. And that's what John does as a prophet. John doesn't just point to this way of life through repentance. John also points to the one who is to come that is going to be the ultimate example of this new way of life. John points to the coming of Jesus, who will be the light that shines in the darkness, showing us and guiding us in pathways of love and peace forevermore. John prepares our hearts to receive that example in the person of Christ. That prophetic witness, it continues to inspire us today to also come down to the river, just like John called out to those people in his time. Because I think, just like those people that came to the Jordan River 2,000 years ago, we ourselves are yearning to be shown a new way of life that we can live in today that is going to make us experience a more full measure of aliveness for ourselves and for the world around us. We desire that knowledge of salvation that John promised to show the people. We desire that compassion and mercy poured out from God on high so that we can experience compassion for ourselves and that in return we can show that compassion to others. We desire and are yearning for light to break into the darkness of these days, waiting to see the God who walks with us through these dark valleys and who guides us through the valley of death itself. And we are yearning for a guide, someone to show us what actions we can take as we want to live out of those same desires that God has for us, as spoken perhaps through the word coming from the prophet Micah. What does the Lord require of us? You may say, what does the Lord desire from us? But to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. John calls us back to align our desires with those same desires of God. But finally, as we are entering into this new church year, this season of Advent, this time of preparation for us, I want to acknowledge honestly that it's not always as simple to just prescribe certain specific tasks or ways of life that can make things better. And in the midst of a difficult year like 2020, I believe that this season of Advent is actually calling us not specifically just to new actions, but into a way of contemplating and being aware for how God is speaking to us today, how it is that we can discern what actions are right and beneficial for ourselves and others today. And to not get ahead of ourselves and to just start doing, but to spend some time in prayerful reflection and contemplation of how it is that God is continuing to prepare our hearts and speak to us today. In that spirit, I want to turn to a contemporary of our time, perhaps some may say a prophet, but certainly people would say a spiritualist or a mystic out of the Christian tradition, whose name is Thomas Merton. We're going to be using a prayer from Thomas Merton in this season ahead during our midweek Advent services as a prayer to ground us and as a prayer to listen to God as we spend some time in silence each week. And in our worship service today, at the end of this sermon, I want us to be able to speak this prayer together, being able to acknowledge that we don't necessarily know the way ahead, but we do know that we have a God who comes to us, who is guiding us, and who is willing to show God's self to us in the midst of this darkness. If we pray, if we wait, if we listen, and trust that God is here. So Ian will go ahead and bring this prayer up onto the screen, and we'll allow this prayer to be the closing words of the sermon today, as we acknowledge and wait for God to speak to us again today. This comes from the book Thoughts in Solitude by Thomas Merton. I invite you to speak together with me these words on the screen. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does, in fact, please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, I will trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen.
Let us join together in confessing the communal faith of the Church in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we walk through the darkness of our days, let our hope and our prayers now offered to God generate life for us and our world. We pray for the light held in congregations and church communities throughout your world. Motivate our work, guide our planning, and give us courage to meet the challenges and struggles of this moment. Turn our hope into inspired actions. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the light held in all living things. May we care for the land and all creatures entrusted to us, acting as wise stewards of the natural resources that sustain our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the light held in human communities, societies, and cultures. May the voices of the prophets of our time be heard as they call for equality, dignity, and peace to reign over all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the light held in the people we pray for today, those who are suffering, ill, or alone, and for all who cry out for compassion and mercy. May we be light for those walking in the darkness. We pray especially for Jan Ruiz, Morgan Pohl, Harold Walker, Gail Larson, Dorothy Riglin, Pat Sandstead, Bill Margheim, Paul Parsons, Dorothy Van Dusen, Jean Ryan, Jim Moss, Eric Larson, Justine Eggert, Lisa Santangelo, Brian Braun, Bob Scrivano, Elena Martinez, Heidi Simon, Diana Hilt, Renee Schroeder, Danielle Zambrano, and Ethel Dixon. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
We pray for the light held in those who are persecuted and harmed for their acts of faith, love, and love around the world. For all who dare to live fully as you created them to be, despite how they are received, we give thanks for their prophetic witness. Surround them with a great cloud of witnesses. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Dwelling in your goodness, we trust that you hear and feel all of our prayers, those on our lips and those held deep within our being. With confidence in your mercy and compassion, we pray together.
Loving Christ, who lights our way, receive now our prayers and our offerings. You give us the gifts of faith, our hope, love, peace, and joy. May these gifts transform us so we may become humble vessels of your grace poured out for the world. Nurture our Advent journey that we may become hope for all who we meet on this road we walk. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Today, at this time, we celebrate our offerings and gifts. You can do so in many different ways, dropping them off at the CTK office, by donating online at ctkdenver.org, or through direct electronic deposits at thriving.com, your own bank, or simply giving in Banco, which you can sign up for here at our office. We want to acknowledge and thank you all for the many gifts that you continue to share with us for the sake of our mission as Christ the King here in Southwest Denver. We also today in our service want to acknowledge and thank so many of you who made your giving commitments for this next year ahead in 2021. Today I have the basket of those gifts here with us in worship, and we are going to speak together a short spoken prayer to offer these commitments as a blessing to God for the sake of our ministry as the church. I invite you to pray together with me. Let us pray. God of generosity,
we give you thanks for the blessings you share with us, which provide for our needs each day. Today we offer these blessings back to you through our generosity and financial commitments for this next year. Multiply these gifts through your love so that they may become blessings and hope for all people. Amen.
Amen. Also during the season of Advent at this time of offerings, we're going to be highlighting ways that you can give to others in our communities and our world to be able to love and serve our neighbors. Today, we're going to highlight two opportunities through community ministry. And the first will allow Joyce Newfield to share with you in a video.
Hi, I'm Joyce Newfield, Executive Director at Community Ministry. Like so many other events this year, Caring by Candlelight has been a victim of the pandemic, and we're having to go virtual rather than have an in-person event. It makes me really sad because Caring by Candlelight is my absolute favorite fundraiser of the year. Seeing all the women, the beautiful decorations they have on their tables, eating all the delicious food, listening to the testimonies, hearing the special music, my favorite things to do. But this year we're going virtual, so what we've tried to do is capture some of these elements in a video that will be available to watch on our website December 1 through 5 and on our Facebook page. We would encourage you to watch this together as a group via Zoom or whatever social media platform you use, or if you can and feel comfortable, have a few ladies over in your home. One of my friends is actually taking her desserts to her various friends' houses, leaving them on the doorsteps, and then they're all getting together on a Zoom call so that they can participate together in Caring by Candlelight. Another lady is going to be sending out special invitation envelopes and encouraging her friends to donate as they would on the Caring by Candlelight night. Now, you still get to participate in the silent auction. However, it will be an online auction, which will also be posted December 1 through 5. Be watching for the links to those different events that you can participate in Caring by Candlelight, the virtual event.
And so again, we invite you to support community ministry this next week, starting on Tuesday and going through the end of the week, by participating in their Caring by Candlelight fundraiser. More information is available on their website or on their Facebook page. You can also contact our church office if you have any questions. Also, we are celebrating the Giving Tree through community ministry this year, and you should have received on Thanksgiving Day an email with a link to sign up to be able to provide Christmas gifts for families who need support with those Christmas gifts this year. We have adopted 20 families that we are getting gifts for, or I should say 20 kids. You can sign up on Sign Up Genius through that link in your email, or contact us this week at the office to sign up. You are able to buy gifts, or you can make a financial contribution and we can help buy those gifts for you. Please keep an eye on your email for other ways that you can help support community ministry during this season. At this time, I invite you, as we prepare for communion, to have your elements of bread or a form of drink before you as we get ready to celebrate the meal. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious Creator, source of life. Your Spirit has always been with creation, guiding its development, calling forth life, infusing beauty, inspiring joy and love. In your infinite love, you created us in your image and allowed us to share in the precious gift of life. You gave us a home in this beautiful world to live in harmony with you, with one another, and with all of your creatures. But we have so often turned from your wisdom. We have chosen our own way and broken faith with you, our neighbors and our fellow creatures. Now all around us, we see the tragic harvest of the bitter seed we have sown. Yet through it all, you have remained faithful to us. You graciously called us to turn from our destructive ways and return to you. You send us prophets, priests, sages, storytellers, and poets to lead us to repentance and wisdom. In the fullness of time, through Mary, a humble woman full of faith, you sent Jesus into the world. Living among us, Jesus loved us. In word and deed, he proclaimed the good news of your reign. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners. In an imitation of your perfect love, he taught us to love neighbor, stranger, outsider, and enemy. He redirected us from violence to peace, from fear to faith, from rivalry to mutual service, and from worry and greed to generosity and joy. We remember that in the night before he showed us the full extent of his love, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples to eat, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for remembrance of me." Gathered as one family around our own tables from our own places of joyful reconciliation and fellowship, united in your spirit, we receive these gifts and gratefully offer you our lives. As Christ stretched out his arms upon the cross to welcome the whole world into your gracious embrace, we rejoice to enter that embrace and with you to extend it to all. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to the living God be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Oh, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
From wherever you are, and with whatever elements are before you, because God loves you just as you are, with whatever you've done or left undone, and in spite of anything that the world says about you, we proclaim together that all are welcome to receive these gifts from God's table today. For in Christ all means all, and the gifts of God are free. You are welcome to celebrate communion today by simply eating of the form of bread and the form of drink that you have with you, or by dipping the bread into your drink. We will first commune those who are alone today, and then you may use the words on your screen to offer communion to those who are with you at home. Let us celebrate this meal. This is the body of Christ, given for you. This is the blood of Christ, shed for you. Please use the same words on your screen to now share communion with those who you are with today. And I invite you to hear now a blessing. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Christ the King, the bread come down from heaven.
As we journey through Advent in the darkness of each day,
we will remain hopeful as we love like Jesus.
As we encounter setbacks and struggles,
we will remain loving as we live like Jesus.
As we witness the chaos, divisions, and violence of our world,
we will remain peaceful as we give like Jesus.
As we serve our neighbors and tend to those in need,
we will remain joyful because we are alive in the story of Jesus.
May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May God look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let us go forth in joy and peace to love and serve God and our neighbors.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you to Lynette and Sue for your leadership in worship today, and for Ian, who has been our technical assistant. We are grateful for all of your participation in worship today, and we pray that this time may offer just a little bit of hope at the beginning of the Advent season.